Ukrima Media's quality, I'm Thabi Madiba. Joining me today is Namibian journalist, publisher, anti-apartheid and press freedom activist, Gwen Lister, here to discuss her memoir titled Comrade Editor on Life, Journalism, and the Birth of Namibia. Many know you as a press freedom activist, investigative journalist, and founder of the Namibian during colonial rule. Can you briefly tell our viewers a little about yourself growing up in the East London and getting a convent education?
I grew up essentially all over South Africa, my father being a bank manager who was transferred from place to place. So I was all over the show there, and I finally ended up going to the University of Cape Town, where I graduated in 1975. I was an activist during my student days, and I really wanted to make a difference to try and change the horrible specter of apartheid and mold the different options open to me to do that. And eventually I sort of decided that journalism would be perhaps the means that I should choose. And so eventually I managed to get a job at the Windhoek Advertiser here in what was then Southwest Africa. I reckoned at the time that if change came in Southern Africa, that it would happen a lot quicker in then Southwest Africa than it would in South Africa itself. So I decided to make that my base to tackle apartheid essentially, and to show the world what was happening, especially in colonial occupied Namibia under the jackboot of apartheid.
And can you tell us more about your Rosa Parks experience in Cape Town, which awoke your conscience, as you say?
I was conscious of the sort of divide between black and white in South Africa, perpetuated, obviously, by the apartheid regime at an earlier age. But I think it was the Rosa Parks moment, as my daughter later called it, my aha moment, that really galvanized me into action, if you could put it that way. And I was basically getting on a bus as a schoolgirl in my very early teens. And an elderly black woman got on the bus and was supposed to go up the stairs to the top section of the bus where the black people had to be and white people downstairs. And I was sitting at the front downstairs, got up, gave her my seat. And the both of us were subject to a barrage of abuse from fellow passengers. And I think that really electrified me to say, Gwen, whatever you do in life, you need to do something to challenge the scourge.
And can you briefly tell us more about your journey as a journalist in Namibia, as you just mentioned, and the pressure that came with being a reporter in that country?
Yeah, well, when I started out, which was early 1976, as you probably know, there were very few women journalists in Southern Africa at the time. And those that were there were generally doing softer beats, you know, be it the arts pages or entertainment. But I insisted I wanted to be involved in political journalism. And my then editor at the time was absolutely opposed to women basically in the newsroom. And he said to me quite bluntly, they belong in the bedroom and in the kitchen. And so really I was subjected to a total baptism of fire to prove to this sort of maverick male editor in Southern Africa, who was renowned in his own right, Hannah Smith, that I was capable of doing the job. And so eventually, obviously, we started on the Windhoek Advertiser. That was taken over by internal groups eventually who wanted an internal settlement for Namibia. And we started together the Windhoek Observer in 1978. And after 6 years, he found the pressure was too much. My political reporting was not getting advertising from the then mostly white advertising community. And so I got the boot from the Windhoek Observer. And then it took me a year to start the Namibian, which I did in August 1985.
And talking about your political reporting, can you tell us why a lot of people didn't like it?
Well, essentially, I think what I was trying to do was then present the human face of the liberation movement, the Southwest Africa People's Organization, SWAPO, as it's known. And as you know, the South African apartheid government at the time depicted it very much in the same way as they did the ANC, that this was a communist movement intent on bringing communism to the southern tip of Africa. And I knew, having had over the years subsequently a lot of contact with the SWAPO movement in exile, that it was definitely not a communist movement. And so I really tried to, if you like, show their face to Namibians, both black and white Namibians, and to say, look, this is something of an inevitability, that it's going to happen sooner or later. And so obviously that engendered the anger of particularly the South African security forces, who targeted myself and the newspaper and our staff on a number of occasions, trying to get us to shut down or to put the fear into us that we would stop doing what we were doing. Because of course, especially after the founding of the Namibian, we focused a lot on showing the atrocities that were happening at the hands of apartheid forces, particularly in northern Namibia.
And you experienced your first taste of political violence at a SWAPO rally in Katutura. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, what would happen was the position of SWAPO at the time was unlike the ANC. It was quite a strange phenomenon that SWAPO, the ANC and PAC were banned movements in South Africa, but the SWAPO was not banned in Namibia, but at least in legal terms. But certainly the security forces did not encourage SWAPO rallies or gatherings, and their leadership were targeted and detained under our security legislation, then known as AG9 and AG26, which were effectively detention without trial proclamations. And so SWAPO would hold a rally and it would kind of go ahead and everybody would arrive for the rally. And that, in those days, many thousands of people. And then the security forces would find some excuse or another to basically wade in and break up the rally, whether it was with tear gas or rubber bullets or real bullets at time, and then arrest most of the speakers who were there. So it was kind of constant targeting of anybody who was perceived to support the liberation movement.
And can you briefly tell us more about your father's accusation when he was drunk, that it was because of you that he lost his job at the bank? How did that make you feel?
It was one of those moments where, you know, when you choose a career of activism and you prepared as an individual to face the consequences of what you are doing, it's one thing. When the consequences of your chosen path affect, for example, your family members, whether it's your children or your parents, it becomes another matter altogether. And gives one certainly pause. And yes, my father was then later in the 70s transferred to Namibia, where he was then employed by Barclays Bank. And subsequently, as I became more renowned in the white community as a journalist, he was targeted. And, you know, we had the same surname. I always kept my own name, which was Lister. And most of the people in the bank, and certainly the big white clients of the bank, felt that it really wasn't a good idea to have someone called John Lister, like Gwen Lister, heading up a banking institution. And so he was basically transferred out of Namibia in a downwards promotion. And I think as a person who loved his job, and I think I inherited that gene from him, we are committed 24/7. It was devastating to him as an individual. And that, as I say, it still worries me today because I don't know the full story of what happened, but at the same time, it affected him as an individual and he was never the same after that.
And lastly, your home had been raided by security police, you received bombing threats, and you were also blacklisted. So can you tell us what gave you courage to continue soldiering to your pen, which also led to the birth of the independent newspaper, The Namibian?
Maybe some people would call it an inherent stubbornness, but I've always stood on matters of principle. And if I commit myself to something, I do it 100%. And I think it was really when I was 4 months pregnant with my daughter and I was detained under AG9, which again is the detention without trial proclamation. I wasn't in jail for very long because there was a lot of pressure from international organizations to release me. But I had that moment, certainly sitting in the jail cell and thinking, look, what I'm doing, is it affecting my children? What if it does? What if I don't live? Because at the time, you know, there were many threats that were happening around me and to me. And I thought to myself, I shouldn't be deterred from the path I had chosen, and that one day I would speak to my children when they were of a certain age and ask them, would they have preferred to have a mother who had been able to spend more time with them as children, take holidays with them and things like that? Or were they happy with the path I had chosen to make that commitment to fight apartheid with everything in me? And I was happy to know when I spoke to both of my children at age probably about 16 and asked them that question, and both of them said that I did the right thing. And so I felt really empowered, even though a mother is always plagued with guilt. And we know that from most women who take on any kind of career, that there's always that sort of internal struggle of whether you're committing too much to your work and to your passion than you are to your children. And so I was at least happy that they affirmed the fact that I had done the right thing and always stand up for human rights and justice. And I think fortunately, they've inherited that sense of compassion and caring, especially for those who are more marginalized.
That was Gwen Lister speaking to Krimer Media's Polity about Comrade Editor.